This podcast is brought to you by the Albany Public Library Main Branch and the generosity of listeners like you.
What is a podcast?
God, Daddy, these people talk as much as you do. Razib Khan's Unsupervised Learning.
Thanks for listening to the ungated version of the Unsupervised Learning podcast. If you want to read some essays on some of these topics, please check out razib.substack.com. Again, that's razib.substack.com. Thank you.
You know that genetics plays a huge role in our health, and more people are using genetic testing to determine risk for diseases like cancer for themselves and their kids than ever before. So I want to tell you about Orchid. It's the only company that does whole genome testing for embryos, testing before your child is born. If you're doing IVF, this is a clear choice now, because now you can reduce risk for thousands of single gene disorders, including heritable forms of autism, pediatric cancers, and birth defects. Check them out at orchidhealth.com.
Hey, everybody. This is Razib with the Unsupervised Learning Podcast. And today I am with a returning guest, Peter Nimitz, talking to Peter about his new post, The Crisis of the 23rd Century. This is not the 23rd century of like Star Trek. This is the 23rd century BC. If you don't know why the 23rd century is a big deal, you will know from this conversation, and I invite you to actually dig into it in more detail. And if you already know that it's a big deal, I think you're going to learn a lot in this conversation, because not only was it a big deal in Mesopotamia or China or maybe the Indus River, you know, Indus Valley civilization, it was also a big deal in Inner Asia and also in Europe. And we're going to talk about it and how that ties in to paleogenetics, historical linguistics, demography, et cetera, et cetera. I think you're going to enjoy this. This is going to be a pretty deep dive into a rich area that's still on the frontiers. And, you know, check out Peter's post, Crisis of the 23rd Century, Upheavals from Spain to the Yangtze. It is on his Substack, Nimitz, nemets.substack.com. And obviously there's a link to it here in the show notes, but just check it out. It's really good. It's really long. And I really enjoyed it. And that's why I wanted to have him on, because I think a lot of you guys are interested in the same sort of things. And, you know, let's dig into it a little bit in a conversation format. Peter, can you quickly introduce yourself and then give a high level summary of what you're talking about here? And then we can go from, you know, topic to topic.
Sure. My name is Peter Nimitz. I write the Nimitz Substack, N-E-M-E-T-S. Really interested in prehistory, wild adventures, a lot of the same stuff you're interested in. And, you know, a while back, you know, there was, I think it was the coming of the Greeks, you know, written back in the 1980s, talks about kind of the arrival of the Greeks from, you know, the Balkans and Ukraine into, you know, what's nowadays Greece, you know, happened around 22nd century BC, you know, and then I was reading some other stuff, and it talks about kind of the crisis, you know, the fall of Akkad. Akkad was kind of the big empire in Mesopotamia back, you know, and they collapsed in the 22nd century. And, you know, also read about, you know, Egypt, the first intermediate period, which is kind of the end of the Old Kingdom and the transition into the Middle Kingdom. It also occurs around the 23rd century. And when I was reading those by themselves, it was, everything was just kind of by itself. I didn't really see any, you know, links between them. But then I was reading more and, you know, notice there's a lot of stuff going on in Central Asia and Siberia and Spain.
Wait, bro. Akkad, tell them what Akkad is, because I think like a lot of people are not like quite clear, because there's a movie, I think Scorpion King, where Dwayne The Rock Johnson plays the last of the Akkadians, but the issue is it has nothing to do with the real Akkad, which is northern part of modern Mesopotamia. So go on.
Gotcha. So Mesopotamia originally have like Uruk and Sumer, you know, these very, very old civilizations that go all the way back to the 4000s. And in, you know, kind of towards the end, I think it was like the 25th or 24th century, you have the arrival of a Semitic group of people, the Akkadians, from kind of like northern Mesopotamia, and they go and kind of conquer the rest of Mesopotamia and unite it under this kind of large empire under a guy called Sargon. And it lasts, I think, about 180 years before it finally collapses, and it's overrun by these barbarians from the Zagros Mountains in western Iran.
Yeah, that sounds. I mean, that sounds like a good capsule. So go on with your narrative. I'm sorry I interrupted.
Oh, okay. So as I was just kind of reading more and more about kind of the Middle Bronze Age, I realized, you know, there's all this different stuff that's going on basically across all of Eurasia and East Africa. And, you know, I found out I was actually not the first person to figure this out. There's actually a series of papers that was, I think it was the Germans did it back in 2015. It was like 2200 BC, you know, and just kind of archaeological summaries, mostly focusing on Europe and the Eastern Mediterranean. Spencer Wells, your old boss, actually sent, you know, that over to me. So I read all of those. And, you know, so I read a bunch of those, and then I put that together with the stuff I was reading about India, East Africa, and Siberia, and wrote this giant post, Crisis of the 23rd Century, which tries to tie everything together. And I think it was decently successful.
Yeah, I mean, so this is basically, it's kind of a synoptic post where all of these individual elements are spoken of or written about pretty extensively, actually. So if you read any up-to-date stuff on Mesopotamia, or in particular, actually, China, they will talk about this crisis during this period. China saw a massive shift from urban centers, kind of shifted towards the Yangtze. Those all disappeared, I think, around this period or a little after. And it shifted actually more towards the north in Hainan, what eventually became, you know, Shang Dynasty core zone. So a lot of things happened during this period due to this crisis that had knock-on effects that show up in the history that we know of. And so can we start with Spain, I think, because that was like one area where you dug pretty deep. Like, talk about who was in Spain and who came to Spain and, you know, how that might be related to, you know, the crisis.
Sure. So Iberia, you know, I prefer using Iberia since there wasn't really, like, you know, the Spanish don't arrive for a really long time.
Okay, nerd. Yeah. That's fine.
So, you know, Spain, even going back in like the Paleolithic, Spain was intensely regional. You had stuff like the far northwest would be inhabited by like a totally different group of hunter-gatherers from the people who lived along the Mediterranean coast. And that pattern, you know, survives, you know, for a really long time. And, you know, it's not super clear. You know, it looks like kind of the population movements from the Eastern Mediterranean towards the West that led to the kind of the rise of the Minoans, the early Helladic peoples, that kind of thing, you know, where they're more like Caucasian shifted rather than the... So originally, like Europe, it's the Western hunter-gatherers. They kind of like rule the area, except Spain was kind of weird and where the Northwest had this like separate group of hunter-gatherers, which had been in Europe for a really, really long time before the Western hunter-gatherers kind of destroyed them.
Yeah, let me just jump in really quickly here, because this is like new information, new papers. Not everyone's read it. So the Western hunter-gatherers, epipaleolithic or, you know, yeah, they're epipaleolithic people, whatever, Mesolithic people. They are associated with an incursion maybe from Caucasus, Eastern Mediterranean, Balkans, show up in Italy, and like say like after the LGM around 15,000 years ago, these are the hunter-gatherers, qua hunter-gatherers that the farmers are meeting, except there are a few places like Spain where there's an older lineage that goes back to the Magdalenians, you know, the cave painting people, et cetera, et cetera. And there's admixture between the newcomers and the Magdalenians so that there's a synthetic hunter-gatherer population. And when we get these farmers coming in, they mix with these hunter-gatherers, and you can now with the best genetics, you can detect the Magdalenian sample. So the stylized fact we used to say, we as in people that read this stuff, like maybe with Kiyome Fu's paper about the Ice Age and genetics, was basically all the ancestor of the Magdalenians is gone. But that's not true. In places like Spain, you can detect some of it. It's at low fractions, but it's there. And that's what you're alluding to.
Yeah. Like there's still people in Spain even today with Y haplogroup C, but like a really divergent lineage that goes to the Magdalenians rather than, you know, the more common East Asian variants.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, this is, you know, you're mentioning C. That's not a common Y haplogroup for Europeans. Mostly Europeans are R, J, G, E. So if you look at the letters, you can actually like see in the clustering of the letters that it's either derived from ancestral North Eurasian RQ, P star, I think, or the ones like J, K, E that are all clustered together out of the Middle East. And then there's I, which is related to JK, and that's associated with the Mesolithic. When you're talking about C, you're talking about stuff that's more associated with East Eurasian populations today. But 40,000 years ago, everyone's barely out of the Middle East. It wasn't as well sorted back then. That's what you're alluding to.
Yes.
And so, go on with your,
Sure. So, cultural, racial, whatever you want to call it, diversity, still, even after kind of the arrival of the early European farmers, which the early European farmers, like the closest related group to them today is the Sardinians, who are like 80% early European farmer in ancestry. It looks like they kind of sort fairly early on, like there's some of them that go into, Northwest Africa, even back in like the 4000s. But eventually, the hunter-gatherers, they have this big resurgence, 4400 BC, they take over the kind of surrounding farmer groups and kind of mix in with them to create, the bulk of the population, which lived in Iberia prior to the arrival of the Indo-Europeans around 2500, 2400 BC. It looks like kind of the southeastern group of Iberians might have had contacts with like the Minoans, since they do have that kind of like Caucasian hunter-gatherer ancestry, or like Iran Neolithic, that's more like Eastern Mediterranean shifted. So I think there were probably like multiple language families spoken in Iberia at the time. There are probably some groups that were speaking the early European farmer languages. Some of them are speaking the Western hunter-gatherer languages, like Basque, I think, is probably a Western hunter-gatherer language. And then some are speaking these kind of Eastern Mediterranean languages, maybe distantly related to Georgian or something. So what happens is, around 2500 BC, it looks like there's like very recent paper, like within the last week, actually, there was like an epidemic of like this louse-borne disease that looks like it kind of ravaged Europe. And that, as well as the, it looks like it specifically spread from like kind of like Scandinavia elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And so the combination of that plus the Indo-Europeans like figuring out how to make these really high quality boats, kind of enabled what had turned into like these Viking pirates to do like these kind of giant land invasions of France, Britain, and Iberia. So they go and like a couple hundred, so, 200-300 years before, Christ, the 23rd century, they go and they successfully invade kind of like northwestern, Iberia, even as they're taking over like Britain and, France. Now in the southern part of, northern Iberia was kind of primitive at that point. It had the Belbeker culture, which was, a multi-ethnic material culture. Like there were a bunch of different groups that had it.
In real quick about the Belbekers. There's arguments and debates about it. But basically the closest to a consensus position is that the first Belbekers are in the Tagus River area in western southwest Iberia, Portugal today. And this motif of the Belbekers spread north and east. Somehow it got into Indo-European speaking populations. And they're the ones that really, really spread the Belbeker culture all over Western Europe. It's pretty much ubiquitous and pervasive in places like Britain and France. But in Southern Europe, it shows up in I think the Balearics, and then also in Sicily, just like in pockets. There's some Belbeker items and probably migration into North Africa, but not extensive. And then you have places like Central and Eastern Europe, where there's kind of like Indo-European back migration from the west, from the Rhine Valley. The Neolithic farmer ancestry increases a little bit because those people had absorbed that ancestry in the border between France and Germany and the Rhineland. And the Belbekers also show up and in large parts of Western Scandinavia, they overwhelm the older Badlax culture. And they're associated with haplogroup R1b, I think the M269 mutation. I'm going to feel stupid if that's not the right one. But in any case, it is the right one. So that's just the context that I want to set into this multi-ethnic Iberia that you're talking about.
So you've got kind of the Indo-European groups, or at least I should say Indo-European derived groups, since, you know, it's very possible that these groups ended up adopting the Basque language for some weird reason. Like the Basques have the matrilineal culture. So, you know, you could have these Indo-European war bands that would get assimilated into these kind of existing, female centered clan networks. So it's very possible they're all, you know, Basque speaking, even though they obviously, I think they were like 40% Corded Wearan ancestry. So they're in the Northwest Iberia. And then in the South, you actually have these, this fairly sophisticated civilization that had extensive copper working, in the Guadalquivir River. So kind of like, you know, where Cordoba and, the old Umayyad Emirate and Caliphate were based out of, you know, thousands of years later. And there's a lot of like archaeological signs. They had settlements all over the Guadalquivir River Basin. They, were cutting down all these forests for like fuel. So they definitely had like a fairly substantial population, and they were capable of holding off the, you know, these kind of Indo-European barbarians for a long time. Kind of the northeast of Iberia, it looks like it was kind of a war zone between, you know, whatever like alliance or confederation or, you know, kingdom or whatever was based out of, kind of southern Iberia and these, kind of northwestern Iberian, Indo-European or Indo-European descended groups. So it looks like they kind of had a, you know, this ongoing war struggles that dragged on for centuries. And the crisis of the 23rd century, you finally see this climate shift, which has kind of like two big effects. And it's possible there are other factors too, but the authors of the archaeological papers I was reading, you know, very much believe it was a climactic shift. In the South, you have kind of like a decrease in rainfall, which leads to droughts, and that causes all sorts of downstream effects, like the settlements, for that kind of early European farmer civilization in southern Iberia, they start to become fewer in number, but larger in size. So it looks like, you know, people were kind of retreating to the upper part of the Guadalquivir River basin, which would make sense if they're facing kind of like a pirate threat. Some of the earliest, I think like the earliest, like Indo-European find in like the Bay of Biscay, which is a bit to the north, is like from a coastal site. So I think a lot of the kind of invasions for the Indo-Europeans started off coastal and then moved inland. So there's that. And then you also have...
Wait, you're talking about Iberia?
Yes. I mean, the Bay of Biscay is like to the north. And I know that's like three centuries earlier anyway.
Well, I mean, so the issue with Iberia is like, you know, the Pyrenees, they are substantial. Like anyone who's read the Song of Roland, which is semi-historical, but in any case, it captures, how treacherous that area is. So, you know, if you're thinking of agro-pastoralist people, and by the time they got to Western Europe, there's more agro than pastoralist probably, or at least like in terms of herding by that region. You know, they're obviously like sheep, but, you know, the big massive pastures were not there, especially in the south of France. And so ecologically, there'd be a very different population and quite adaptable in many ways. It's pretty interesting thinking about it. So, and these aren't going to be like caravels, they're not going to be big vessels, but basically like coast huggers, you can imagine them coming from Gascony or elsewhere.
Mm-hmm. That's similar. I mean, the Basques were really big seafarers. So, you know, did they do that 3,000 years before the Middle Ages? I don't know, but I think it's worth considering. So at the same time, like in the northwest of Iberia, since the Indo-Europeans or Indo-European derived groups were agro-pastoralists, they actually had an increase in rainfall, and that caused kind of a decrease in the salinity of the soil, which I guess caused issues for the crops they did harvest. I'm not an agronomist, so I'm not super sure on the specifics of that. But anyhow, it looks like they actually did a mass migration and abandon their northern area, the northern area that they lived in, to migrate all the way to the south. And it looks like they did succeed, they had kind of like a conquer or die scenario, maybe like the Manchus in the 17th century, where, you know, their harvests were going poorly. So they decided to go and conquer China so they wouldn't starve to death. So I think, you know, might have been something like that. So they go down, they successfully conquer this like southern civilization. And from the DNA, you know, it looks like in some parts, you know, it's just the usual, like, you know, kill the men, rape the women kind of thing. Because there is like quite a big genetic impact It's just not quite as big as it was in the north. So there probably were some like holdouts in various parts of southern Iberia, maybe in like, you know, Granada or something. But definitely in like the southeast, they, you know, conquered the locals. Because we do have some DNA from them, which very much shows, I think it's like 100% of them are the R1B for the bellbeakers.
Yeah, so this is, I mean, there's some David Reich lab papers about this. It just goes from like, you know, I2, I think, to and G2, you know, we're talking Y chromosome haplogroups here, some J, whatever, and to like 70, 80% R1B really quickly. Even the Basques are actually very, very R1B, partly because they were not, after the Indo-European migrations that you're talking about, they were minimally affected by things really after the Iron Age. So they didn't have much influx, you know, during the Roman period, et cetera, et cetera. In Reich's paper about Spain, you can see that the Basques have this, you know, as you were saying, at least 40%. Corded wear type ancestry. And then after that, they just kind of stopped doing things with other people around it. I want to get the periodicity. So it's obviously the 23rd century. Can you get the periodicity like any more precise than that? You know, so the 23rd century would be what? That's the 2200s?
Yeah, 2200s. I think a lot of this stuff happened, you know, from the climatological data from 2240 to about 2160.
Okay. All right, go on. All right, and so that's the situation in Spain. Do you want to talk a little bit about Italy and how it's similar or different? Because I think Italy is a little bit, I mean, look, geography determines a lot of these things. Yeah. My impression is actually, and when you can go into this and like, you know, you might have your own take, but actually there's kind of like a west-east gradient in how early and extensive the Indo-European imprint was in the northern part of the Mediterranean. In terms of Greece was a little slower, a little later, the penetration was not as extensive. So if you look at the fractions before the Slavic migrations and the old Mycenaean samples that Lazaridis started publishing, but later there's other ones with the palatial civilization paper, they look much lower than Spain. And Italy, from what I know, is kind of in the middle. But just go on.
Yeah, I mean, the issue with Spain was it looks like, you know, I mean, there's some other stuff that suggests maybe there was like outbreaks of diseases or whatever that devastated the Mediterranean populations. Because there is, I think, you know, a find, one in Crete and one in Sardinia of, God, not cholera, I'm trying to think. I mean, do you know what I'm talking about? Like there was some, I think it was like last year that...
Was it Yersinia pestis or a different one?
No, it was a different one.
Okay.
Because the Yersinia pestis came like right around 2800 BC with the initial.
Okay, yeah, I don't know which. I'm not that extensively. Also, you are talking about a disease paper that just came out in the last couple of weeks.
Yeah,
I'll put a link to it. It's not referred into your post partly because it wasn't out. Basically, I'm just going to give a quick capsule for the listener, the viewer, you know, or mostly listener. But in any case, it looks like with agriculture, obviously villages, there's a cranking up of pathogen load. Okay, we expect that. But what they found is around the time of the Yamnaya expansion, there was like a second stepwise increase. That's what you've been alluding to. Mm-hmm. And that probably weakened a lot of the Neolithic civilizations. Why did the Yamnaya make such a big difference? So, you know, cattle culture was prevalent after 3000 BC in places like Britain with the Neolithic societies that actually de-agriculturalized and kind of pastoralized, so to speak. So why were the Yamnaya different? I mean, I think the only explanation can be is they had scale and interconnections. They were part of the broader Eurasian steppe, pathogen, zoonotic, you know, environment. And so that's one of the things, the zoonotic diseases from animals became a huge thing after the spread of the Yamnaya. And, you know, there's still, you know, I don't think we can make a general assertion here about like how that impacted the interactions with other peoples. But look, most of you who are American know what happened with the Native Americans. This sort of stuff makes a massive difference and, you know, changes civilizations and world history. Like ask about the Black Death and, you know, increased wages for peasants in Western Europe and the decline of serfdom, right? Like these are sort of things that I'm talking about.
So it looks like in Spain, actually, at least in the southeast of Spain, the shift from kind of like the early European farmers, mostly agricultural society, and, you know, they had some like, they had farm animals too, but the pastoralism you know, kind of the agro-pastoral lifestyle introduced by, you know, the Indo-Europeans or the Indo-European derived groups, actually like increased, you know, the population of the area. All of a sudden, like the El Argar culture, that's the archaeological culture that's associated with the Indo-Europeans, kind of overrunning like this southern, you know, Iberian EF society. You know, they have all these extra archaeological sites that appear like right after the crisis of the 23rd century. So that's why I prefer like the crisis rather than collapse, because, you know, with the fall of Rome, basically everything outside of like Egypt and, you know, the Levant just totally disintegrates. You know, whereas this was more like kind of what happened in the Little Ice Age, where a lot of people did go under, you know, like the Ming Dynasty collapses, Germany, you know, disintegrates. You know, but there were a lot of people that managed to endure it and kind of set the stage for the growth in the next century. And I think that's what happened in Iberia. Italy.
Well, just to be clear, and I will let you go to Italy, just to be clear again, to set the context for people, obviously, you know, we have cuneiform records. You know, there was like massive, you know, the collapse of Sargon's empire, all these other things, the rise of the third dynasty of Ur, you know, civilization in Mesopotamia, civilization as we know it, civilization, you know, the first interregnum after the fall of the Old Kingdom, the West Asian civilizations that we know that are literate. They did get through it, the rupture arguably was, I would say, not as extreme in West Asia as the fall at the end of the Bronze Age with the arrival of the Sea Peoples. For whatever reason, there was more integrity, I think. But it was a big deal from what we have records of. And in China, we don't have writing because the, you know, oracle bones don't show up for like another, you know, say 700 years or so, right? The archaeology shows actually probably a bigger hit and transformation of winners and losers. And obviously in Europe, we don't really have writing yet either. And so maybe it was the same. You know, maybe this has to do with the more northerly position of China and Europe vis-a-vis West Asia. I don't know. We can talk about that later, but go on to Italy.
Sure. So Italy, you know, as far as I could tell, looks like there are three separate invasions of Italy. There were, you know, one, we actually know the names of the Sicanians. They're mentioned in Thucydides' History of the Peloponnesian War. So the Sicanians, they were a group, you know, in the 5th century BC. They were living in kind of central Sicily. But it looks like they actually conquered the entire island back, you know, right around the 23rd century. And according to Thucydides, they came, you know, from what's nowadays eastern Iberia. And the DNA actually confirms that, like, you know, the Y haplogroups found from, like, you know, late third millennium BC Sicily are downstream of those, or, you know, very closely related to those that are found in, you know, Iberia. So,
wait, so I have a question. Sure. I saw that. That's fascinating. Why would Thucydides think that? Is it because the Sicanians themselves remembered? And also, they were, you know, after them came the Sicels. So there were these, like, these two peoples that were interacting. The Sicels were the new people that were on the coast, and then the Greeks show up. So you have, like, you know, Phoenicians. So you have this like multi-ethnic Sicily during the time of Archimedes and stuff like that before Rome actually conquered, and then, you know, obviously changed everything. Although Sicily, just to be clear, I don't want to go on a tangent, but Sicily, to be clear, for much of its history was actually part of Greater Greece in antiquity, but also during the Byzantine period. So that's why there's you know, still Italo Greek communities in Sicily, I think. But anyway, go on about Italy. And, you know, influence from,
Oh, yeah. So to answer your question, there's an embassy from one of the Sicanian cities that went to Athens. And I think it was actually the city that invited Athens to go and attack Syracuse during the Peloponnesian War. And I think, you know, Thucydides, I think, personally met their, like, ambassador, you know, one of the guys who was there. You know, and that guy, like, told him the history of the Sicanians, and Thucydides managed to add that into his history. So I thought that was really cool to see that, you know, bit of history be vindicated. So they go, they invade Sicily. I think that, you know, it's not like a total genocidal invasion. I think they only replace like 20% of the population, you know, which makes sense. It's a pretty decent area to live in. It's not, you know, like Spain, you know, it's kind of like desert in some parts, whereas Sicily is pretty decent. So it looks like, you know, in the north, you know, there was a pretty big invasion. You know, with like total cultural discontinuity. I think, you know, and I'm not like the Terramara culture, I think, is kind of the ancestors of the Italian speakers. So I think these people would have been the Ligurians. So they would have been kind of like, you know, the third branch of you've got like Celto-Italic. I think it would have been like Celto-Italic Ligurian if you went back like 4,000 years. But we really don't have that much of their writing. So
in Italy, there's people coming in through the Alps kind of, or in that area. And then also you're talking about these maritime people. So are we seeing I'm just from reading from your post, I'm imagining pincer movement of Indo-Europeans a little bit. Am I wrong?
I mean, I don't think it was coordinated. I think it was just kind of, the drought happened in the Adriatic. The farmers can't grow enough crops. Their civilizations start to collapse. They already have, through the Bellbeaker culture, these contacts with foreign peoples. The foreign people start coming in as like mercenaries or invaders, and they start just kind of taking over in a lot of the places the north, where they get overrun. But it's just kind of, that's like the first invasion. I think, the Italians come later and there's other groups. Then obviously the Celts end up showing up at kind of the Bronze Age collapse period. You have the Scanians that sail all the way from eastern Spain. They conquered Sicily. And then the Iapygians, they sail from the Adriatic and kind of conquer like the southeastern part of, what's nowadays Apulia, kind of like the southeastern part of peninsular Italy. And I think we have some DNA from them, even though it's quite a bit later, because it's from the Daunians. We do have some from 1,000 years later, about 1200 BC. And I don't think there was like a huge cultural turnover in the next 1,000 years. So I do think that's probably when the Iapygians arrived. And they're like referenced in the early Roman history and stuff. The Romans had wars with them. They ended up being part of like the whole Roman alliance system. And so they hung around for quite a long time. So a lot of like the Italy of, so kind of like the first parts of what would become recognizable as classical Italy were laid down during this crisis of the 23rd century.
Yeah. So let me just talk about what we know about classical Italy. And some of it is, we're talking like, let's say like 5th century, whatever, when it starts coming into history, because like the Greeks, Greek cities of the south do mention Rome and other places. Rome is geographically strategic. It's at the border between the cities of Latium, which are like, modern day Lazio, Indo-European speaking. And then to the north are the Etruscan cities, Tuscany. And Etruscan is clearly not an Indo-European language, but genetically, and I've written about this on my Substack, and it's pretty clear, there's very little difference between these Etruscans and the Latins that are their neighbors. The two probably engage in reciprocal gene flow extensively. There are Etruscan nobles that were integrated into the patrician class actually very early on. There are also other groups like the Sabines and the Umbrians. I think the Claudii are Sabines. Sabine women, obviously. Probably those are all Indo-European speaking. I think all of them are Indo-European speaking, except maybe the Ligurians were not, besides the Etruscans. So I'm trying to get a sense of like the multi-ethnic nature of Italy. But, so there's a non-Indo-European society that seems to persist. There was actually discussion of migration from Eastern Mediterranean. There's an island, I think it's Lemnos. That has an Etruscan-related language in the Aegean, which seems kind of weird. So it's not totally solved. Right now, it seems leaning towards the idea, I think most people do, that the Etruscans are from the Villanova culture, maybe, and that they're indigenous and they're descended somehow from early European farmers culturally. Clearly, they are not Indo-European in a lot of their practices and their gods, which actually did get integrated into the Romans. The last mention we have of Etruscans actually happened during the Visigothic sack of Rome, I think like 409. And so the Etruscans disappear as an ethno-linguistic group and a language sometime probably in the first century AD. The Emperor Claudius was actually an Etruscanist before he was elevated to the purple. He was probably one of the last major people that could speak and write and like knew a lot of Etruscan history. And he wrote a bunch of books that disappeared and were not preserved. Okay. But the Etruscan religion, their rites continued with people that now switched to Latin, but their ancestors were Etruscan. And so that's just like an interesting cultural twist that, these sorts of like ancient religious practices can way, way outlast the ethno-linguistic group. And so that's what we know about Italy in history. And what you're talking about is, okay, how did this come about? And some of these populations that you're talking coming from the north, coming from Spain, they are precursors to what we see later, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so in terms of the chronology, like what's your impression in terms of when they arrived, when they kind of established, when did stabilization equilibrium happen in Italy after the 23rd century?
I think there were kind of like, there were multiple periods of, and I think going all the way back, like the 23rd century, this is like the first big set of invasions to Italy. There's another one about 1700 BC. There's another one about 1200 BC with the Bronze Age collapse. So the one 1700 BC is, I think, when the Italics came over. 1200 BC looks like when the Celts came over and kind of established themselves in a Cisalpine Gaul. You know, then you have the historical or recorded invasions that happened every couple centuries. Like, I think it was, when did the Gauls sack Rome? Like 500 BC, roughly?
It is 390, I believe.
390, okay.
Yeah, so.
Okay. And then about 250 years after that, there's the Cimbri that invade. And then no one really invades Italy again up until, you know, the migration period.
Yeah. Basically, that sounds right. So we have like these periods of like stability and equilibrium, and then these shifts. And so we have the Italic languages in the north. We have, you know, in Cisalpine Gaul, which is Gaul on the side of the Alps. I think, you know, just reading from what I remember, you know, there's an old perception that these are, you know, invaders kind of from over the other on the other side. But like, what is your opinion based on what you've read and seen in terms of archaeology? Like, are the Celts new or are they actually been around for a while?
For Cisalpine Gaul specifically?
Yeah. I mean, because I think like there's some connection to the Urnfield culture of the late Bronze Age, supposedly, with the Celts. So maybe they're all new. I don't really want to get distracted by the Celtic question. You know, there's like the hypothesis that they arrive late, that they are early with the bell beakers, all of these things. Do you think like in your reading of the Italian archaeology and whatnot, like that there's anything that sheds light on that?
I mean, it's not something I'm super familiar with, but my understanding was they came largely, you know, with the Bronze Age collapse. It's Cisalpine Gaul. Yeah. Before that, it was kind of the Italic speakers. You know, and the Italic speakers got pushed south into Rome.
Okay, so you're an Urnfield culture guy. I got it. That makes sense. And also, so Cisalpine Gaul, just for people out there, basically it's Padania. It is the Po River Valley. It is, you know, the whole area. It's Lombardy, basically. It's all Lombardy. All of the mountainous stuff, no, but it's Lombardy. Like, all of the lowland areas were supposedly Celtic speaking before they were assimilated and integrated by the Romans. And, you know, I have a friend from Bologna, and, you know, he was telling me that, you know, in Bologna, they claim that they are descendants of Roman soldiers that settled in the area after the conquest. So that's the belief there. And, you know, I mean, genetically, obviously, Northern Italians are more like other continental mainland Europeans than Southern Italians, but it is pretty much a Cline, and they do have connections to people to the south. So I'm just putting that out there. So we're talking about Italy. Let's get to Greece. Greece and the Balkans. Like, I mean, tell me what you know about that, and I'm gonna have some opinions here.
Sure. So, you know, originally back on the steppe, you know, it's nowadays like Ukraine, southern Russia. You know, kind of a mix of people. You've got like the you know, a lot of different groups, some of whom were, you know, split off centuries apart from each other. You had like the Greek speakers, the Indo-Iranian speakers, you had the Slavic speakers, you had the, I guess the Slavic speakers were probably in the swamps by that point, in like Belarus. And then you had the Armenian speakers. And it looks like probably around like the 25th, 24th century, the Indo-Iranian speakers like totally wrecked the Armenians and the Greeks. So the Greeks, they go and they flee into the Balkans where they hang out for like 200 years. And the Armenians, they go and they cross the Caucasus and, you know, end up in kind of like Armenia, eastern Georgia, western Azerbaijan area, like Kuraxes Valley, more or less. So the Greeks, they go, they kind of mix with the, you know, there's a lot of devastation in kind of the Balkans, which is probably associated with their kind of like pastoralist ancestors invading. And then, you know, once, you know, Christ the 23rd century hits, you have like these droughts in Greece. They see their opportunity. They kind of storm into the north, but kind of the Helladic peoples are still, you know, they're very sophisticated and strong. They have a lot of ties with the Eastern Mediterranean, and they're able to like hold them off. So the Greek, rather than, you know, like the Armenians stormed in, it looks like they, you know, did the usual, like murder the men, rape the women, that kind of thing, just because you see kind of this massive shift towards the R1B haplogroup. Whereas in Greece, it's, there's the shift towards the R1B, but it's not nearly to the same extent. And from what we know from Thucydides too, like he's kind of like a gold mine for early Greek history, or for Greek prehistory, I should say, since he was he had a very analytical mind, it could kind of piece together some of the truth from a lot of the myths. So, rather than the Greeks kind of, they do go in, they kill a bunch of people and kind of like the north, I think it's like Logcast is the sample up in the northwest, like right up by the Macedonian and Albanian border. But they go and it's kind of like a gradual growth of like an alliance system that is how the Mycenaean period goes. So the actual like Hellenification of Greece isn't until maybe like 500 years after, the arrival of the Greeks in the northern Greece.
So northern Greece, this whole area that you're talking about in the Balkans, and there's some papers that came out about Albanians that indicate this with ancient DNA. All of these groups, and this is in my post, which many of you have listened to, and if you haven't, I mean, I don't say this very much. Like if you're just like listening free or whatever, that's fine. You're not getting my emails and stuff like that, but I have a really long post about Indo-Europeans that you can find and you can read, and like it'll outline everything I think about this. Corded work complex that Peter, have alluded to multiple times clearly is ancestral to probably Italic, Celtic, Germanic, Balto-Slavic, Indo-Iranian, but it probably is not ancestral to Illyrian or Greek. They are probably descended from the original, from Yamnaya that pushed into the Balkans, really into the Trans-Danubian region and into modern-day Hungary pretty early on. And they were a separate penetration of Europe from the early Corded Ware people that are more located in, say, eastern Poland, western Belarus. And, they would not actually bring the R1B M269 probably initially, or R1A, which is the other main haplogroup. So what happened later on probably is there was Corded Ware type people that also moved south. But ethno-linguistically, I suspect that the reason that Greek and Illyrian are so unique probably is because they don't come out of that Corded Ware split. Although I don't want to overdo it. Corded Ware emerged around 2900 BC. There might be like 400 or 500 years of extra split, from those branches to Greek and Albanian, depending on how early you think the tribal differences between these different Indo-European groups are. So when you're talking about Greece, the earliest period, you're talking about populations or culture that are not quite Corded Ware. They probably have some Corded Ware genetic influence because the Corded Ware and bell beakers are spreading everywhere in some ways. Because I think you do see that, and you talk about in the Y haplogroups right there. So, but Greece and the Balkans are actually quite different in this early period because they're not part of that general pan-European Corded Ware expansion. I think that needs to be noted. We have Linear A, which is probably not Indo-European. The Minoans were probably not Indo-European. The first European civilization, as we understand it, with literacy. We know that the Pelasgians probably mostly were not Indo-European. These are people mentioned by the Greeks. There's legends about the Athenians being autochthonous to the region. I mean, there's mythological explanations to this, but really it could just be their Indo-Europeanized Mediterranean people. In Greece, in what became Greece, in this Aegean civilizational area, there's a lot of earlier, dense, culturally sophisticated, and robust non-Indo-European populations that really delayed, the Mycenaean takeover that happened after about, like, what was it, like 1450, maybe after the Santorini explosion, whatnot. So that's the context there. Whereas, like, again, the other extreme would be Iberia, where it seems like, I mean, people argue whether Tartessian is a Vasconic language or not, apparently in Spain, but my understanding is probably as Indo-European, but I don't know.
It's interesting that Lazaridis and the other guys think it was kind of an early branch of Yamnaya rather than catacomb, rather than the catacomb culture, which kind of remained in the steppe and was kind of, mostly a Yamnayan ancestry.
Yeah, well, so the catacomb culture is post-Yamnaya without the Corded Ware, right?
Yeah.
So it could be like they followed on to the earlier ones. I mean, the details are still to be worked out. So for the listener out there, catacomb culture is basically a culture that's the successor to the Yamnaya on the Pontic steppe. And I think from the genetics and everything we know, we it's pretty much like, yes, it's mostly Yamnaya, where the corded ware is about like 30% Neolithic farmer and 70% Yamnaya. And so the idea is the catacomb culture maybe gave rise. I think that Tholos tombs of the Mycenaeans, there's some archaeological things that connect the Mycenaeans to the steppe. There's also things relating to Mycenaeans. David Anthony has talked about that, connecting them to Indo-Iranians culture. Now, this seems really bizarre, but think about where the Indo-Iranians originally were on the steppe at that period of the catacomb culture. They're going to be right to the north and east of the catacomb culture. So these two cultures, even if they're genealogically distinct in the medium term, because Indo-Iranians are definitely from the corded ware, while the catacomb are not, they could still share features through simply just being in geographical proximity. And then when you have the catacomb people going south into the Balkans, and the Indo-Iranians obviously going to the Indian subcontinent, they still maintain those similarities, even though they're obviously geographically very distinct. And genealogically, they're not particularly close. Greek is not particularly close to the Saddam languages of Balto-Slavic and Indo-Iranian, right?
Yeah.
So, go on, Peter.
Oh, yeah. It looks like some of the catacomb, per catacomb, like, so there's the whole theory of like Greco-Armenian, that the Greek and Armenian languages are, more closely related to each other than they are other Indo-European languages. And that's kind of where the idea that, associated with some of the archaeological ideas that the catacomb culture was the source of both Greeks and the Armenians. And it looks like there might've been a branch of catacomb that survived what's nowadays like Kalmykia, kind of to the, just to the northwest of the Caspian Sea, kind of like a desert region. All the way up until the crisis of the 23rd century, when you have the Lola culture, which appears to be genetically identical to Steppe Mykop, which had been on the opposite side of kind of the North Caucasus, goes and kind of like descends from the the Eastern Caucasus and kind of like wipes them out in Kalmykia.
Yeah, so Armenians are definitely also, by the way, this is even more certain than the Greeks. They definitely are post-Yamnaya. They have Yamnaya Y. Lineage R1B, and so yeah, they are not corded ware. There's arguments about whether they come through the Balkans or whether they come through Caucasus. I'm not going to get into that, but they're definitely like the Afanasievo likely ancestors of the Tocharians, not corded ware, derived from a different Yamnaya branch. So just to put that out there again, like all these groups are not that like distantly related, but there is some internal structure. It's not all just like an unstructured explosion. And that's kind of what your post is getting into. You talked a little bit about, I think, the Caucasus.
Yes.
And the Pontic Steppe. Can you get into that? So, Caucasus between the Black Sea and the Caspian, the Transcaucasian, and the Kuban Steppe to the north. And then imagine the area basically where Russia and Ukraine are fighting now, Pontic Steppe, and go east towards the Volga, right?
Yes. So it looks like... it looks like there were kind of three separate groups. There was, kind of the remnants of the catacomb, which were in Kalmykia, which I mentioned. There were, the Indo-Iranians who are based out of like Ukraine, southern Russia. And then you have, the Lola culture, which is in kind of the East Caucasus. Then you have like the Dolmen culture, which is the ancestors of the, the Northwest Caucasians, like the Circassians, the Ubiks, whatever. And they're in kind of the Northwest Caucasus. So as, with this climactic shift, it looks like what happened is kind of the peoples who had hidden from the original Indo-European invaders, up in kind of the mountain valleys, they actually descended from those mountains and kind of like invaded the western part of the North Caucasus, which is the Dolmen culture. And then you have the kind of in the northeast, the Lola culture, which might have some I know we talked about this a couple months ago when I was writing this piece up. They might be partially the ancestors of like modern day Chechens and other Northeast Caucasians, but it's not really certain. But anyhow, the main winners were definitely the Indo-Iranian groups, which just overran most of the Volga, even though they're originally based more in like the Dniester and the Dnieper River. Then meanwhile, in the South Caucasus, it looks like the Armenians kind of so thoroughly devastated the area that rather than kind of the crisis of the 23rd century causing, disintegration there, it's actually associated with an increase in a cultural sophistication and the development of new fortified sites and new, metallurgical methods. And that's actually a pattern we see with the Bronze Age collapse too, where the South Caucasus, it has its own collapse around 1500, 300 years before the Bronze Age collapse. But then when the Bronze Age collapse happens, it actually thrives, and it's kind of a lot of its techniques for metallurgy, like with iron bloomeries, end up spreading from the South Caucasus specifically across Europe and the Middle East.
Yeah, yeah. Want to talk at some point about Semiturbino and all that stuff, maybe with you on a podcast. I'm definitely going to write about it at some point. That was also part of the crisis of the 23rd century, probably. Maybe not for sure. I mean, all of this stuff is, you know, ancient DNA gives us a lot of precision, but a lot of the archaeology is insufficiently systematized and theorized. So it's just like a bunch of facts. I think one thing that's great about your Substack and your content is you're going through all of these facts and trying to assemble some, I don't know, coherency out of it. And it's not very coherent. It's just all out there. Let's switch to Middle East. You talk a little bit about the Horn of Africa. Middle East we know about. This is, I think, the period of the Gutis show up, the G-U-I-T-I. But and if you, any of you have read about Mesopotamia, you will know. Talk about that part of the world. Let's move away from Indo-Europeans for a second.
Sure. So this is the part I know the least well. I try to focus on the really obscure stuff and assume that the professional historians can do a much better job on their subjects than I can. So you have the Sumerians. They, you know, have a language that's not related to any other language in the world. They, you know, they didn't really found civilization, but they're the earliest literate society going back to like 3400 BC. I mean, there were probably some previous literate societies, but, you know, they didn't write on clay tablets. We don't have anything from them. Like, you know, earlier we were talking about that southern Iberian society. Strabo, the Roman geographer, actually mentions that the Turdotani, who were in southern Iberia, had 6,000 years of history, which, you know, comes pretty close to the 5,600 years that the early European farmers have been there. You know, maybe they were exaggerating. They probably were, but who knows? Maybe they did have records that went back that far. So the Sumerians, they go, they had a lot of issues where, due to their methods of irrigation and the crops they grew, that the soil had been salinifying and crop yields had been declining across the third millennium. And I think that's one of the reasons why Sargon and the Akkadians, you know, the Semites from kind of the less developed parts of Mesopotamia, they didn't necessarily have the same issues with soil salinity as, you know, kind of the lower part of Mesopotamia. Close to the Persian Gulf, you know, which makes sense because the salt, of course, kind of flow towards the ocean. You know, they're like, you know, they're literally the soil that provides them sustenance is more lively than that of what the Sumerians have. So they go, they overrun it, but ultimately they kind of get corrupted by, you know, the same issues with the soil. And finally, when they have this climactic shock, you know, the water levels, the Tigris and Euphrates, they fall by about 150 centimeters. You know, it's a meter and a half. It's pretty substantial. A lot of the irrigation systems get messed up. A lot of their legal system was actually evolved out of the need for water distribution. So it would have caused all sorts of issues with like lawsuits and, you know, delegitimized, you know, the various religions, whatever. So actually by the by the turn of the 21st century BC, the records that we have, because, you know, record keeping didn't totally collapse, crop yields had actually fallen by half from what they had been at the turn of the 25th century BC. So there's all these rebellions, you know, the Sumerians, they rise up against the Semites, you know, which are the Akkadians. You have these Gutians, or the Guti, who come down from the Zagros Mountains, it's mountains in western Iran. They go and they overthrow the Akkadians. Akkad itself, I think the location is like widely suspected, but people haven't like found it for sure. You know, and kind of the heartland, the Assyrian and Habor plains, where like ISIS was pretty active in and like doing mass executions, whatever, a couple of years ago, they were largely depopulated during that period. Yeah. Like there's barely any archaeological sites.
I do want to say later Assyrian, the Assyrian language is basically a form of like evolved or derived Akkadian, just to be clear for people who are curious.
And then in Anatolia, it looks like they kind of like the South Caucasus, they did have, you know, they endured the crisis. Anatolia is the Asiatic part of Turkey. It looks like they kind of endured the crisis in a lot of ways. Like there was a population decline. Certain areas were, did kind of fall in population. There's fewer archaeological sites. But at the same time, like it looks like state authority, the political system did not collapse. You have an increase for the settlements that do survive. They do become larger, and like the monuments there are larger. At least some polities like did. I guess like the best parallel would be like Russia, for instance, in the 17th century. A ton of people died in the time of troubles and, the various struggles they had with the Tatars and stuff. But the government was actually stronger by 1700 than it had been in 1600 because of those crises. It forced it to become more militarized, forced it to, kind of reemphasize serfdom. And it looks like that's probably what happened in Anatolia as well. And then Egypt, they have the first intermediate period. I assume like the priests kept literacy. It's just a lot of the records got lost.
Monument dropped. Yeah, I mean, we know that they kept literacy because Manetho, like as late as like the 3rd century BC or whatever, has a record of all the dynasties back to the Old Kingdom, right? So there was continuity.
Gotcha. And I think, have you read the, I think there's a big ancient Egyptian paper that's going to come out soon, right?
I have not read that. It didn't come out yet, did it?
No, it hasn't come out. Like some of the results were leaked, but the results were leaked.
It's like, yeah. What were you asking though?
Oh no, just if there's a big shift associated with the first intermediate period.
From what I've heard, it seems like it was just like gradual over time, and the major spike is during the Islamic period, and we're talking mostly sub-Saharan African ancestry.
Gotcha.
There.
Okay.
Although there has been stuff, obviously, from been other places too that happened in the West Asia, all of it, like the West Asian, like Western Iranian, Zagrosian farmer ancestry just kind of gradually increases over time in Egypt from, 7,000 BC when it's like close to zero to, today when it's as common as like the native Natufi, post-Natufian, right? Indigenous,
Gotcha.
Yeah. So let us move to the Horn of Africa. What do you know about that? What's going on there?
Yes.
This is like Ethiopia, Somalia, et cetera.
Yeah, this is my one of my favorite prehistory topics. Just, there's so little research done on it. And I have to go back and do like Google Translate on these old Italian archaeological digs. Really cool topic. So it looks like East Africa. So like in Eurasia itself, there had already been a lot of like homogenization from the Bronze Age. We have like these very distinct populations, like the Western hunter-gatherers, the steppe people, the Caucasian hunter-gatherers, the Natufians. They're all mixing together. They're forming like new population groups. It looks like in the 3rd millennium that had not, there were some places like the Nile Basin and like the Sudan where it had happened, but in a lot of the Horn of Africa, it had not. You have like a lot of the people who speak the emotic languages, which are probably, at least talking to some linguistic friends, not a real linguistic. It's kind of like a waste basket taxonomy for languages that look like they have some like Cushitic or Semitic influence in southwestern Ethiopia, but really are part of their own, totally separate language families. So it looks like that group of people, they were like their own totally separate population. They hadn't really mixed with anyone, and they were kind of living in the Ethiopian highlands. You had like another group that had like some distant affinities to the Pygmies, even though they weren't necessarily like ashore. They were living around like Lake Turkana, the kind of northeastern part of the African Great Lakes. And then it looks like, and this is very hypothetical. We don't actually have the DNA from these coastal groups. We just have like some of the extant like groups like the Sandawe that look like they're kind of enriched for this kind of ancestry.
They clearly are. I've looked at Sandawe genotypes. I mean, it's unmistakable.
Yeah, it's like this coastal group that looks like it stretched possibly as far north as Eritrea, and then as far south as kind of like a southern, like southeastern South Africa. And it looks like that group might have spoken languages related to the Tuu languages of Botswana and South Africa. And it looks like they practice kind of like fishing and beachcombing. So you have these like three very different hunter-gatherer groups that are like totally unrelated, totally different ways of life, like the lacustrine people, you have the highland people, and then you have kind of like the coastal beachcomber people. So the crisis of the 23rd century, it looks like what happened was the Lacustrine people suffered like really, really badly because you have the decline in the lake levels, which they rely on for their livelihoods. Like all of a sudden, the animals that they rely on to like hunt, are dying off. I think like hippopotami bones become a lot less common like in that period. And you have the arrival of these people who practice the pastoral Neolithic lifestyle. And the pastoral Neolithic people, it looks like the ones who had moved into what's nowadays like the southwestern part of Somalia, are actually like almost identical to contemporaries living in like what's nowadays northern Sudan. So it looks like they migrated up the Nile and then kind of into these areas that were drying up since they had cattle herds and they could kind of like graze them on the grasslands now that the kind of hunter-gatherers that had held them off for so long had kind of vacated them. And it looks like some of these hunter-gatherers might have actually held out into like the 1960s or 1970s, when these rebel groups got their hands on like World War II weapons and exterminated them.
Dude, that's dark. That's dark. I made a face. Like, we're not gonna do a video for this episode. I don't know. I just made a face. It's just like I was like, okay, like that's like some fucked up shit. Maybe I shouldn't swear because like now it's gonna be like not a clean episode. But some of this stuff is past was brutal. It was bloody. There's a lot of interesting stuff that's going on in Africa. In my Bantu post, I don't want to like mention. I've been doing the Substack for like 3 years now. There's a lot of posts that address like elements of this, so I can just like point people to it. But yeah, my Bantu post to talk about like a lot of the stuff in East Africa is totally different during this age. Middle Kingdom Egypt, Old Kingdom Egypt, even down into the New Kingdom. Basically during the Bronze Age, East Africa was entirely different from what we know today. A lot of it is probably you find more of it in the Horn of Africa, where the Bantus did not penetrate, for ecological, climatological reasons, et cetera, et cetera. So I think the archaeology combined with paleogenetics is exposing a lot of interesting things. And as you know, as a lot of the listeners know, Cushitic genetic influence actually went all the way into South Africa among the Khoi people, who are obviously, they are Khoisan, click speakers related to the Bushmen. And they have ancestry that's probably from some sort of like, maybe Nilotic or Cushitic or whatever, but like, people that went as far south as like Mozambique and assimilated well before the Bantus arrived, before the Bantu people arrived, around like 2000, 1500, maybe as late as 1,000 years ago in some places in southern Africa. There had been Cushitic pastoralists who were absorbed into these tribes who themselves became Cushitic, but they retained their language and kind of their cultural identity, which is much, much older in that region of the world, right?
Yeah. I mean, it looks like some of the pastoral Neolithic Cushitic peoples, even though they kind of took over a lot of these grasslands, it looked like the hunter-gatherers actually like coexisted with them, for 2,000, 3,000 years in a lot of cases. And I think, there's some groups like I've been trying to, I've reached out to a bunch of Somalis. I'm trying to get someone from the Ile clan, E-Y-L-E. I'm probably mispronouncing it. I can't speak Somali. Who are supposedly like recently assimilated hunter-gatherer group that was considered non-human by Somalis. And they only like got added into the one of the big clans, like the Rahang Yane clan, I can't pronounce it, within the last two centuries. So I was hoping to get, gladly pay for like a full genome nebula DNA testing for one of them just to see if that's true.
Yeah, I'm going to have
to go
awesome.
To Somalia to find one though. But
maybe you shouldn't go to Somalia, bro.
Yeah, probably not.
Maybe Somaliland in the north. I think that's a little bit more stable. There's some tourism there. But, this whole coexistence between foragers and nomads, pastoralists, I think it's like something ecological. I mean, I don't believe 2,000 years these nomads were just like, oh, like we'll just leave our hunter-gatherer brothers alone. No. The hunter-gatherers could resist them because the nomads didn't have an ecological advantage. Bantu clearly did with a new cultural toolkit. And it's just interesting to note that. You also, let's pivot back to Asia, talk about South Asia a little bit. I don't really know too much about this. I have the book, I think, that you actually are referring to, or you have a picture of the book in your post about South Asian archaeology. I have not read it all. I should read some of it. But can you talk about the Indus Valley Civilization and whatnot, and then we'll pivot to Siberia maybe to close it out.
Sure. So Indus Valley Civilization, they're kind of like what's known as Pakistan, northwestern India. And they actually, you know, it looks like they endured it pretty well in the initial phase, because the growths of the 23rd century have like the initial climate shock, which happens, you know, about 2240 to 2160. But then there's kind of like a gradual change that drags on for like three centuries after that. And it looks like that gradual change, you know, did a lot more damage to the Indus Valley civilization than the initial climactic shock, you know, because they had irrigation, they had, you know, fairly sophisticated drainage systems, might have had flush toilets, just like their contemporaries in, you know, the Minoan civilization. So they changed a lot of the crops that they farmed. You know, one thing, you know, and there's some like botanical evidence for this, is that they sailed all the way, you know, that they had contacts with East Africa, specifically probably with like the Cushitic groups that were living in what's nowadays like Eastern Sudan and like Eritrea. And they spread certain crops that were more like drought resistant over to, you know, India. Now, the earliest finds in India for that crop, it is pearl millet, I think. Yeah, it's pearl millet. So it's a better drought-resistant crop. So the early finds of it are actually in West Africa, you know, and it spread all the way from there to the Indus Valley civilization, where its earliest finds are in the 18th century. I wouldn't be surprised if it actually was introduced like a century or two earlier. So they definitely, like, they knew there were problems. They adapted to them. And it wasn't enough in the end. But, you know, at least for a couple centuries, they managed to hold out. It does look like, you know, in Central Asia, there were some kind of pre, like even before the Aryans launched their invasion of the Indus Valley civilization, you know, it does look like there were some Central Asian groups that invaded Baluchistan and kind of devastated some parts of that region.
Yeah, and Baluchistan, that southwest Pakistan, just so people know, I mean, there's probably some influence from Iran, maybe even in Southern Arabian Peninsula. It's off the, it is off the typical South Asian cline. Off the Indian Cline, then the Cline is like, you know, ancient ancestral South Indian with West Eurasian ancestry. That's mostly a mix of, you know, Indo-Aryan plus the IVC kind of Eastern Iranian ancestry. And so if you do a principal component analysis, there's a Cline, you know, goes by geography, caste, mostly maybe a little bit of language. Bengalis, like my ethnic group, is off the Cline because we have East Asian ancestry. And the people in Baluch, unlike the Pashtuns to the north, are also off the Cline, and that's because they have more distinct types of West Asian ancestry that are not found in other parts of the subcontinent. A lot of people just assume it's new, which it possibly is, but maybe it could be older, you know, in light of what you just said there.
Yeah, because there are, you know, even like the Bactriana, Margiana archaeological complex, there's obvious signs of immigration from the Indus Valley civilization around that time, and presumably it would have been a two-way street. You know, meanwhile, further south to the Deccan. So the Indus Valley civilization just kind of declined, but, you know, wasn't wrecked. It looks like the Deccan or Deccan, how do you pronounce that? The big peninsula, the big,
yeah, bro, I would say Deccan, I would say Deccan, but bro, like, I'm not gonna lie, I don't really know.
Okay. I just read this stuff. I have no idea how it's pronounced. Like
many, many such cases, including your, you know, your host here.
Oh, yes. I like, you know, the Russian outfit, no, it's so much easier.
No, Indian friends of mine. Actually, so I have a friend. I should have him on the podcast. He's actually Jewish, but he lived in India for a long time. And he always makes fun of the way I pronounce things because he lived in India as an academic. And he's like, yeah, like you definitely pronounce it like a total white person. But anyway, we're talking about the Deccan.
Yes, the Deccan. So that's the big plateau in central India. You know, always... So India is kind of like divided into regions. You have kind of the Indus Ganges Valley, which is in the far north, where like what 80% of the population lives. Then you have the Deccan, which is kind of the central plateau. It's kind of dry, not as populated. And then you have kind of the south. And, you know, that's a huge oversimplification. But so the Deccan plateau, it looks like it was just totally devastated in the crisis of the 23rd century. It looks like there's kind of these cattle herding migrants from the north. The settled people, they have their settlements get overrun, and it just kind of like reverts to barbarism. So this might be when the Dravidians kind of like started spreading from the Indus Valley civilization, which they might have been like either a peripheral or main part of, as they like, you know, migrate south. A lot more work definitely has to be done, though.
All right, let's pivot to Siberia, the Lena River Valley, which actually, like, I'm super interested in now.
Yes. So Siberia, you know, back when I started like really getting into this stuff, maybe like 15 years ago, I was always really interested in like the Paleo-Siberian languages. It'd be like the Yukagirs, the Chukchi, the you know, the Ket, and it's all these languages that weren't really you know, related, and you know, people just kind of put them together because they're not related to anything else, as opposed to like the Turkic languages, Russian, obviously, the Tungusic languages, which is like Evenk and most famously Manchu, you know, and then the Mongols, probably the most famous ones of all. So it's actually in the last 3 years, the whole story of Siberia has really been clarified a lot. So, for like tens of thousands of years, it was inhabited by these people called the ancestral North Eurasians, who have, you know, like Europeans have a lot of ancestry from them, as do Amerindians. And the people in Siberia actually used to have a lot of ancestry from them as well. And you had like these Siberian groups, you know, who really up until quite recently, with like expansion of like the Asian and Europeans, were kind of like their direct descendants in a lot of way. So, the Indo-Iranians had already pressed into parts of Siberia, as had like the Tacharians, Tacharians, however you want to pronounce it. You know, but they were kind of more limited, like, you know, Western Mongolia, parts of, like the Altai, that kind of area. Further to the north, you had some like very, very different groups, like in Yakutia, which is in the Lena River Basin or Lena River Basin, you know, very, very cold and hospitable area. You have... I'm going to mispronounce this. It's a word in Yakut. It's a Imiyakhta culture.
I'm going to ask, you know, I apologize to my Yakut listeners here. You know, I ask for your forbearance. Do not send an angry Yakut email in Yakut Cyrillic, but go on, Peter.
So the Imiyakhta, they, you know, they're this group, and they look like they have quite a bit of ancestry from further south, like in the East Baikal area, you know, who had just kind of like migrated up north and, you know, replaced like half the population of, you know, just kind of a normal, you know, murder the men, take the women as brides type thing, you know, a couple hundred years before. So they formed Yakutia Middle Neolithic, which is like this population, which looks like it's actually a quite decent proxy for, Yakutia Late Neolithic would be like the Ket and stuff. This would be a Yakutia Middle Bronze Age, MBA, is you know, what the geneticists are calling it in the more recent papers. And this is like the last 6 weeks. So this is...
Yeah, I know. I know exactly what you're talking about. I spent the weekend reading the papers.
Yep, I did too. So, you know, these groups, it looks like they came up with, you know, just this new way of life that was more effective at kind of dominating the far north. So... For whatever reason, so, you know, with this kind of shift towards colder climates, heavier snowfall, they just explode and, like, dominate everyone. They go and, like, totally wipe out the groups to their east. In Kamchatka, they actually sail to Wrangel Island, which is this island off, like, the extreme, like, northeastern coast of Russia. And, like,
wait, did they eat all the mammoths then? Did they eat all, yeah. Is that when they ate all the mammoths? Damn it, though.
So they finished off the mammoths, you know, probably in, like, you know, a century or two. So definitely. And there's, like, actually some, like, some of the groups, like the Yakuts, you know, even though they're Turkified, actually have, like, memories of, you know, like, the mammoths. And there's a guy, like, King Erlik, and he reigns, you know, in his underworld realm with the mammoths and stuff. So they still have, like, you know, even though it's been 4,000 years since they hunted.
Oh, wow, that is crazy.
There still are, like, some memories amongst the Siberian people about, you know, the mammoths. So it's just kind of crazy, but, like, Abraham and, you know, Abraham lived and the pyramids were built at the same time. There were still woolly mammoths around.
Yeah, that's, I think there was one in Siberia, or not in the Bering Strait. They also died. They're probably not human die off, but probably they didn't have enough ecological space as the sea rose. But I mean, I should do like a podcast, like an interview with one of the people that study this, like these late Pleistocene survivals. That's what I'm going to call them. Let's end it with China. We've been talking for a while. End it with China. Talk about China, which, like, there's actually a lot of archaeology in China related to this.
Yes, and this is like the area that I know almost nothing about. I read, you know, I skimmed through the Archaeology of China book just to get an idea. So it looks like you have kind of, you know, unfortunately, so you've got the two big river valleys. You have the Yellow River Valley, which is in the north, and you have the Yangtze River, which is kind of the center of China. And the Yellow River Valley, that's kind of where the original Chinese were based out of. That's where the Sino-Tibetan speakers have been expanding out of since, I think, like, what, 6,000 BC, 5,000 BC with the spread of millet farming?
Yeah, I think it's the millet farmers. Yeah.
So they go, they spread like the Tibetan foothills into the Yangtze River Valley. You know, so they're like obviously have a lot of advantages. And it looks like, you know, in the crisis of the 23rd century, they kind of retreat in some ways, but they advance in others. So like in Tibet, for instance, the colder climates give an advantage to the, you know, local hunter-gatherers, who a lot of whom carried a Y haplogroup D. Similar to the Japanese, they go take over kind of these like millet farming people in the Tibetan foothills and kind of like have this Tibetan expansion from their original home higher up in the plateau. In the Yangtze River Valley, you have, you know, these fairly sophisticated civilizations that just totally collapse. And it looks like they're overrun by people from the Yellow River Valley who kind of usher in an era of barbarism. Unfortunately, we don't have any DNA from like the Liangzhu civilization or anything. As well as the Shijiahe civilization. I think we actually might have some Shijiahe DNA, but we don't have anything from the Liangzhu, which is really unfortunate because, you know, that would kind of clarify just how extensive these collapses and invasions were. So in the Yellow River Valley, you actually have kind of a shift to the north and the west, where, you know, since agriculture is not being as productive as it used to be, you have kind of the rise of these pastoral societies. And I think we have the DNA from one of them on the Ordos loop. There's a theory, you know, Christopher Beckwith, he argued in his book, Empires of the Silk Road, that, you know, the Shang dynasty and a lot of Chinese, they had a Indo-European influence. The Shang would have been of, you know, Indo-European origin. I think like the DNA from these Kijia people definitely disproves that. They are like, they definitely have a noticeable amount of like Siberian and like Amur River Valley ancestry, but like 80% of their ancestry is from the Yellow River farmers, and they don't have like any ancestry from any Indo-European group.
Yeah, I think one of the interesting things that David Anthony, and if you guys haven't listened to the David Anthony podcast, listen to it. If you're listening on the free version of this podcast, also you can listen to it. It's out there. He talked about how culturally a lot of the Pontic Steppe people were actually quite diverse, like in terms of their archaeological traditions. And then when they genotyped them, they're like, oh, they're all very similar. So what you're seeing here, they're kind of like the Papua New Guinea, you know, you see like high cultural diversity in these early agricultural people, but low genetic diversity. So they're like exchanging genes, but cultures remain distinct. I mean, we understand how this works. It's not like genius, but we know now empirically. So what I think you're describing is something quite similar, where the genetic differences are not that great. There's reciprocal gene flow, but the cultural differences are quite salient. What we really understand from China, and what we think of China as China, and people who have read my, you know, works on China know this, is it's basically a lot of it is Zhao dynasty stuff, so to speak. You know, dates to about like, you know, 12th century BC, and that established the ideology of China as a particular type of civilization. They don't do human sacrifice, you know, they believe in heaven and not an anthropomorphic god, etc., all these things. Whereas there were other types of civilizations around earlier in China that were indigenous and ethnic, you know, ethnically related, but those traditions died off, perhaps due to this catastrophe, or just like, you know, competition between the different societies when the Zhao took over and the Shang disappeared. So I think we should, like, you know, kind of close it out right now. What was your big takeaway from just doing all this reading and writing and whatnot?
I thought it was kind of a strike against the like domino effect population theory, which is kind of popular, you know, mostly because the migration period studies, you know, where like the Huns pushed the Germans in the Roman Empire, and, you know, that sets off all sorts of things. And it was you know, really made this strong case for climactic determinism, like everything is reliant on sunspots and rainfall and, you know, how long the Siberian high pressure block goes on in the, you know, winter, that kind of thing.
Cool. What are you working on next in terms of, like, what's your next big post and project that the listeners... I'm going to release this early enough that you're probably not going to be done with whatever you're talking about next, so you can kind of tease it.
Sure. I'm working on a Bronze Age collapse post. It's going to be similar to this, except for the Bronze Age. The Eastern Mediterranean, Middle East has been done to death. So I'm focusing on Siberia, India, East Africa, and the rest of Europe that, we don't have any records for. I can argue that it was a much larger collapse than most people believe.
All right. Well, so, what I will say as we close out, Peter, if any of the listeners here are subscribed to my Substack, and you like the content, I don't understand why you would not be subscribed to his. So go ahead and add yourself to the list. The posts, there are similarities in our styles and stuff and content. So, there's never too much of a good thing. So please do subscribe to his Substack. I think you're going to enjoy the content. And, it's about scholarship and science. It's a little bit more archaeological, I think. You read more archaeology than I do. It's somewhat of a different spin on the same general topic. So I think people enjoy it. It's been great talking to you. I'm sure I'll talk to you. I think you're going to come on a third time, maybe a fourth time. We'll see. I love reading your stuff. And so that's why I want to follow up and talk. And I want more people to read your stuff. So it was great talking to you, Peter. And you have a good day, man.
Yeah, you too. Thanks for having me on.
Whole genome sequencing is used for adults and children every day to assess risk for thousands of diseases. Orchid, a genetics company led by scientists from Stanford, is able to do this for IVF embryos. Now, instead of waiting for a diagnosis, parents can assess if their embryos have genetic variants known to cause severe conditions before their child's even born. No other tests can detect these issues so thoroughly or so early. So check them out at orchidhealth.com.
This podcast for kids. Favorite.